goes by many names: mountain bike, all-terrain bike, fat tire bike.
We sing and we do harmony, and it's refreshing to know that they accept us and they like what we do.
And it's just like you're flying a little bit. You don't even really realize that you're doing a routine except for the pounding your legs are taking in your upper body.
Primetime, lifestyles, leisure, and entertainment with your host, Specialist Leonard Buchanan.
Hi, and welcome to Primetime, the show which shows you what you can do while you're here in Europe. Stay tuned for your first lesson with a military parachute club. Meet four soldiers who sing up a storm. Take a close look at the largest German-American club of its kind in Europe, plus meet a world-class trampolinist that shows that the family that plays together stays together. But first, Kevin Dixon takes us to the mountains of AFRC to show us the little bicycle that could.
Many names: mountain bike, all-terrain bike, fat tire bike, or off-road bike. It's the Jeep of the bicycle world. The great advantage of owning a mountain bike is the immediate off-road access it allows.
Well, it's good to get out in the trees and the trails, and you see a lot of wildlife, and it's just good to get out in the open air and look at what we have here in Germany. It's good views.
Although the mountain bike boom is relatively new to Europe, it was conceived and nurtured in the 1970s on fire trails in Northern California. The early pioneers rode stripped-down paperboy vintage bikes with balloon tires and components borrowed from other cycles. Gradually, these clunkers were replaced by stronger, more durable bikes designed for the rugged mountainous terrain. Three gears at the pedals, plus 5 to 7 at the rear wheel, provide from 15 to 21 speeds. The granny gears increase the range of gears necessary to climb steep grades efficiently and comfortably. Today's breed of mountain bike is high-tech. Lightweight, medium-sized, reinforced frames with a lowered center of gravity make for a better road bike, and the innovations seem to have no end in sight.
This year seems to be the flexibility in bikes. Mountain bikes are now becoming less like a bicycle and more like a motocross bike.
This particular bike is a slingshot. It's made by a company in Grand Rapids, Michigan. The uniqueness about the slingshot is that it is a suspended bike. It has a spring here and a piece of Kevlar here as the hinge. With this unit, it's sort of like a bow holding together, and it either flexes on one side or it flexes on the front.
Experimentation seems to be the rule where mountain bikes are concerned, and oftentimes as you look at them, you may wonder if it's a bike at all. The ability of mountain bikes to climb, cruise, and traverse virtually any terrain has led also to the development of a new sport, mountain bike racing. Sleek, high-quality mountain bikes now race on courses impossible for normal race bikes. Types of all-terrain bicycles available, finding the right bike depends on what you really need. So decide on what you intend to use the bike for, whether it be as alternate transportation or as a recreation vehicle to get away from it all. Then do some shopping around. Your best deals for purchasing mountain bikes can probably be found at your local exchanges. And if you're going to ride on city streets in Europe, lights, reflectors, and a bell are a must. But if your intention is to put this machine through its paces in some really rugged mountainous terrain, then it would probably be wise to pick up some tips and training at a mountain bike school. For Primetime, I'm Kevin Dixon at AFRC's Mountain Bike School in Southern Bavaria.
With new safety equipment and good instructors, the sport of trampoline is making a comeback. Now meet a world-class trampolinist and see how the family that plays together stays together. There are plenty of trampoline clubs around here that look for Americans. First Lieutenant Carl Hager is not only a member of one, but a 15-time national trampoline champion who loves Europe and what it has to offer.
For the sport, this is the best place for me to be because over here is where the people are very competitive in Europe. The sport used to be real big in the States, but the lawsuits have kind of hurt us. And we're rebuilding. We're coming back.
You don't have to be a pro to get started in the sport. It's all in the basics.
If I was to start from the very basic tricks and then build up, you could see how each trick builds on each other. The skills for the basic back somersault are the same skills for a triple somersault, except for you have to be much higher and much faster in the rotation. It's kind of funny. When you start a routine, it's like your subconscious kicks in. And the more you can let your subconscious do the routine, the better the routine's going to be. It's when you start thinking and putting things into it that you start to have problems. It's kind of like an automatic pilot, and it's just like you're flying a little bit. You don't even really realize that you're doing the routine except for the pounding your legs are taking in your upper body.
What does it feel like to hit the trampoline on the way down?
Let's say, have you ever had a car accident? Because, boy, when you hit that bed, you take a lot of impact, especially when you're coming off one of those triple somersaults with a half twist or so, or that triple Cody that I did off my stomach. I'm actually pulling a G. At one point, the bed starts coming back up, and you're still going down. So you feel your stomach start going to your back. It's a dangerous sport if it's unsupervised without the proper safety equipment. But it's just like gymnastics. The trampoline got a bad reputation because we had a lot of people who were just not qualified to coach the sport and getting people up, and it looks easy at first, and they would try the trick and then they would fall off and get hurt. But under proper supervision, I don't have a worry in the world.
Notice the pads at the end of the trampolines. They're soft and can keep a fall from being deadly.
We had those crash pads on the end of the trampoline, and the frames they're on are spring-loaded. So if you come off the edge, you land on that mat, and it absorbs the blow. And I've seen it save countless lives. And 10 years ago, they didn't have that type of equipment.
Well, Carl's been doing this all his life. It's definitely not for the money.
It's all self-satisfaction. There's not, you know, we're not being awarded money prizes, and it's not a big public sport yet. So it's a lot of self-gratification, and I have to say I got a wife out of it. I was sent TDY to a class in Heidelberg for the military, and I had the World Cup coming up that week, and I didn't have a place to train because I'm around from Schwabach, and it happened to be a gym close by where my wife trained, and that's why I started going to train while I was on TDY there. And I met my wife, and after that we started going out, and after World Championships we got engaged and got married.
I saw him the first time, 84, but I couldn't speak English, and I didn't talk to him. And 86, I saw him World Championships at Paris. I didn't talk. I was scared to talk English. I just had school English. I was just 9 years in school, so I didn't talk. And then 87, he comes in the gym where I trained, and that's where it starts. And that's where I met him. I know him a long time, mm-hmm. So that's why I know him a lot before already. I know he's crazy. I know that before.
Carl and Jutta now support one another not only in their home life, but in their sport. And it's a good way to spend family time with their son.
It's great for me because I've never really had a coach when I've grown up. And now I have my wife. And not only is my wife, but my coach. And I'm the opposite for her, too. So, and bringing Kevin to the gym, we can spend time with him yet still get some training in. Whereas, you know, I'm working 9 hours a day in the military and don't have a lot of time with my child. So when, that my wife's in the sport and my child can come and join in is great for us, because then we get to spend time with the family, which is important to us.
With both parents so into this sport, will their son Kevin also be a world-class trampolinist?
I think so. Kevin's already been up doing some back somersaults. He loves to come to training and jump around on the trampoline with us and bounce up and down. And seeing that he has a mother who's ranked 9th in the world in trampoline and a father who's been doing pretty well, I think he'll end up jumping. But we're not going to push him into it. The main thing we'd like to do is just make sure he's athletic and healthy.
We'll be back in a minute to see how Jim Belushi takes care of business in the AFIS movie update and take a look at Europe's largest German-American club. All that and more right after this.
They called her the SR-71, Blackbird. She flew higher and faster than any plane has ever flown. But there's a world where that's not good enough anymore, where the boundaries of technology and imagination are forever being stretched. So if you want a career in tomorrow's higher technology, come to a place where the sky's no longer the limit. Aim high. Air Force.
Background action, please.
Action.
Hollywood has always recognized the comic possibilities of the offbeat matchup. And no duo could be more diverse than James Belushi and Charles Grodin. In their new movie, Taking Care of Business, directed by Arthur Hiller, one is moving up in the world, while the other is sliding down.
I lost all my money.
Wow! I'm on Dynasty!
What I like most about it is that they will come up with something that's funny, that belongs in the movie.
James Belushi plays a convict who escapes from prison to see the Cubs play in the World Series. When he finds the filofax of an overly organized ad executive played by Charles Grodin, he assumes his identity and winds up on Easy Street.
Spencer Barnes, where are you?
He takes over his clothes.
Forget it, man.
His credit cards.
Yeah, I'd like to buy that big screen TV.
His clients.
To success, I want an honest campaign, Spencer.
Honesty, huh? That's good.
Are you familiar with high-quality products?
Oh, yeah, I eat the stuff every day.
And what is your opinion?
Honestly? Well, I think your oatmeal sucks. Nobody likes it. I mean, it tastes like dirt. Chewy dirt. And your bologna tastes like rubber. You gotta smother it with mustard so you don't even taste it. But not your mustard, because your mustard tastes like crap.
And he even dates his boss's daughter.
I'm shy.
You wouldn't know it.
Somehow I feel free. I feel open. Sexy.
Check! Check, please. About two people who are exact opposites. Charles Grodin plays this great character, very tight, very organized. He has everything in this little book, this filofax, and he loses it. And I happen to find it. I kind of take over his personality, his life. And so we kind of trade places in a sense.
This is a disaster.
I was really thrilled when I heard that Jimmy was going to play the part of the convict in this movie. I mean, I know he could play a lot of stuff, but I mean, a convict guy kind of seems...
More like...
Right on.
Yo!
Hi.
Hi.
Oh, you must be Spencer.
Spencer? That's what they call me.
Hi, I'm Jewel. I'm Walter's daughter. I just got off the phone with my father. He's looking for you.
Me? Well, I'm here.
Yeah, there you are. Well, I'm just going to swim a little bit, so don't mind me.
No, I don't mind. Thank you, God.
Wow, this feels great.
Water, you know.
Want to join me?
Me? Sure. Yeah!
I was worried that they cast Chuck because the part of the part that he plays is a kind of uptight, insecure man, and I don't see Chuck that way.
That's good, because I don't even see the part that way. I see the part as like a kind of a macho adventurer.
A toast to the Cubs winning the World Series and loose women.
Working with Jim, you know, watching him carefully over all these weeks, I really learned that a ponytail can look good on a guy.
Yeah, I've learned that women's pants can look good on a guy. Where do you get those pants? Do you get a color or another choice like that? Can we buy these after the shoot? It's a little difficult working with Chuck compared to working with Jerry Lee, the dog and canine. I mean, Chuck's a great guy and everything, but he won't lick my face, you know?
Well, wait till the rap part.
I slept with Walter's daughter?
Yeah.
Alyssa! You were great! I knew I could be great in bed.
I'm Patrick Kaiser, Prime Time.
Reservations, call 633-7225. Stay at Camp Darby and put the Tuscan region at your fingertips.
The Fitness Break with fitness instructor Amy Harper.
Most of us exercise because we know physical activity does wonderful things for the body and mind, but some of us are a little bit shaky on what physical fitness really means. Physical fitness means having the energy and the capability to do the things you need and want to do. Most of you would agree with me that physical fitness also means looking and feeling your best. So let's say you've made the commitment to get physically fit. You work out 3 to 5 days a week, watch your intake of alcohol, eat a well-balanced diet, and get plenty of rest. What more could you possibly do to improve or maintain your fitness level? Take a test. Don't get nervous. It's a simple test. It's called HRAP, Health Risk Appraisal Program. Most fitness professionals look at fitness in terms of components, such as aerobic conditioning, flexibility, muscular strength and endurance, and body composition. All of these components add up to your fitness level, and all of these components can be measured by the HRAP process. For instance, a fast way to measure aerobic fitness is to take the step test. To measure muscular strength, the grip test. To measure flexibility, the sit and reach test. To measure body composition, the use of the Futrex 5000 computer. Don't forget, diet and nutrition play a large part in your level of fitness. A simple test for cholesterol is the finger prick procedure. Keep in mind that physical fitness means different things to different people. Health fairs and fitness appraisals can help you determine your strengths and weaknesses, set goals, and design an exercise program that's perfect for you. Lifestyle is what really counts here. Lifelong commitment to exercise is important for good health and fitness. If you're physically fit, it's a good indication that you're living the good life. Fitness testing, check it out in your community. I'm Amy Harper. See you next month on Primetime.
Welcome back. Stay tuned and meet a group of soldiers who will harmonize their way into your heart. Plus, we'll take you on the first lesson with a military parachute club. But first, it's the largest German-American club in Europe, and there's probably a chapter in your community.
You leave the States, you travel thousands of miles, and you find yourself at a new duty station in Germany. And you know you've left good old Southern hospitality behind, haven't you? That is, until you discover the Kontakt Club.
It's kind of hard for me to be away from my friends and family back home, and then when I come here, it's like they're taking the place, not really taking the place, but they're helping me adapt to just kind of living over here.
For 20 years now, the Kontakt Club has been making people feel more at home. Kontakt. It started out as a one-year pilot program. Only three cities were involved then, but since 1970, Kontakt has grown to a size the organizers didn't think possible. 5,000 members in 62 clubs across Germany. The clubs have launched millions of friendships, and that makes it the largest program of its type sponsored by the U.S. government.
We are bringing together people from America and from Germany, especially soldiers which are stationed over here in Germany. They usually don't know much Germans, except the people they meet on Saturday nights in a bar. And I guess that's not the best point to make relations between Germany and America, because it's not always the nicest people you meet over there. And in our club, you can meet people through all social levels and through all ages. We have typical German events, we've got typical American events, and that's the way we try to afford the relations between the German and the American people.
Just a glance at one of the club's monthly calendars tells the story. Germans and Americans are getting together in all kinds of activities. Castle visits, sock hops, volleyball matches, and barbecues. They're just the tip of the iceberg, and even bigger plans are in the making.
My club this year is sponsoring a trip down to Greece, which is an excellent, excellent deal. Price-wise, it's 450 marks, and ITT, the closest they can come, is 1,200 marks. So we give the soldiers a real break, and especially single soldiers.
It is geared for young Americans and Germans who do not have a lot of money. Most of the things that we do are very inexpensive if you compare them to your average tour company and other clubs. A lot of things we do are free because we as a club, everyone helps out in the event instead of having to hire people to do it for us.
Why do some people join Kontakt? Well, while some people join just to find a cheap way to see Europe, learn foreign customs, or even to just meet new people, there are those who join for more important reasons.
Most of the Germans like to join to learn English or just to talk it because they learn it in school.
I only speak a little bit of German, and they speak enough English that we can get along. And it helps me learn my German, helps me learn different customs, stuff you won't learn just being by yourself in the barracks or something, or back in your room or something like that.
I saw a sign, and then I dropped by one time and became a member of the first evening, and I enjoy to be there.
I come to have a good time. I mean, I like going out and meeting with Germans and interacting with them and finding out more about Germany. That's what I like about Kontakt.
When a soldier or airman signs their enlistment papers, they're making a commitment to the military. Now meet four soldiers who also have a commitment to great music.
According to Army Sergeant Jerry Moore, it all started in the workplace. To be exact, in the motor pool. That's where he and three fellow soldiers agreed to a verbal commitment. Their story isn't new. Soldiers in the same outfit getting involved in a common interest. What's unusual about their foursome are the harmonies. They practice at least three times a week, usually at the barracks when one or the other has duty. When they first started experimenting with their musical talents, reaction was mixed. But someone must have liked what they heard, because they received an invitation to sing the national anthem at a sports championship. The feedback they got was 100% positive.
At first, everybody was a little reluctant to accept it, but after a while, they started realizing it was a pretty decent sound. And after we did the Star Spangled Banner for the boxing championship, they realized we actually had something that may one day be marketable or may someday go somewhere.
Their unique a cappella blending captures audiences wherever they sing. They've been dubbed contemporary, jazz, R&B, and soul. Their songs are remakes of old hits and original material. Commitment is the official group name, one they prefer. All four serve in the same company, Bravo Company, 6th of the 43rd ADA, hence their nickname, the Boys from Company B.
I think the name commitment means a whole lot. That's the real reason behind it. We're committed to what we're doing. The Boys from Company B is a tag that that was tagged on us, being that we're from the unit. Every gig that we do, or every date that we have, a lot of people think we're going to rap. And that's a stereotype that's been put on us. And we sing, and we do harmony. And it's refreshing to know that they accept us, and they like what we do. And as long as we keep doing it the way we know how, I think they'll be gratified, satisfied.
Commitment is proud of their accomplishments. Since their debut performance, the requests have continued at a steady rate. They've sung for American and German audiences, and they like it.
Singing and being a soldier, I like it because of the fact of that you don't see it every day. It's not something that you just, in every unit, you find four guys that sing together, work together, and have such a nice sound as we do. It's something we can do while we're working, something we can do while we're not working. We wake up singing almost.
Most parachutists talk about the rush of adrenaline they feel when they lunge into 1,000 feet of open space. Let's drop into a military parachute club in Bad Tölz and see how you can experience your first free fall.
Parachuting is one of the many activities you'll find on any given day near Flint Caserne. For 25 years, the Bad Tölz Sport Parachute Club has given Special Forces soldiers and others the opportunity to jump for fun off duty. The influence of the club has gained the fascination of other community members over the years. These people are enrolled in the club's jump school, taught by Special Forces instructors. Here, the students learn the basics of the sport, such as packing the parachute, just one aspect of ground school. They further their knowledge in classroom study. Wind patterns, malfunction procedures, and canopy control are a few of the things they need to know. It's now the day of the jump, and a few lessons remain. The instructors teach the students the correct way to land, and they practice what to do once they've exited the aircraft.
Go. Arch thousand, look thousand, reach thousand, pull thousand.
The hours pass quickly. Any color smoke. It's getting closer to jump time. Equipment. Each the briefing of the day informs everyone about safety procedures and current weather conditions. Anxiety grows, and some of the students have nervous thoughts racing through their minds.
I'm really not too nervous. I don't want to think about it because then I'll have to go to the bathroom again. So.
For others, jump time doesn't come fast enough.
It's ready to go. The adrenaline just flowing. My knee's knocking, but I'm ready to go.
The first student jumpers have been selected. They get last-minute advice, then head towards the helicopter for their short ride to jump elevation.
The area is now clear and winds are still light.
Others on the ground watch their fellow students float silently to Earth.
Our students out.
All right.
Ooh. Okay, your FXC is out.
Yes.
In no time at all, a first jump is finally completed.
Sport parachuting, although it might seem dangerous and has its inherent risk, is a very safe sport. We use the ram air canopies, which are designed to open very quickly, give you stability in the air, and allow you to land very softly. We have some of the safest equipment, the best equipment money can buy for our students.
Some of the students have discovered that parachuting can be one of the most exciting events of a lifetime.
I can't wait to do it again. I can't wait.
The sport isn't for everybody, but those who continue jumping say it's a feeling that can't be beat. Specialist Hank Husingfeld, Primetime.
That's Primetime for this month. Thanks for being with me, and thanks to our Frankfurt studio crew. Primetime is your show. If you have any story ideas or comments, or just like the way the show looks, drop us a line. I'll have the address for you in just a minute. See you next month on Primetime.